Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Learning Space. Today's topic is conduction. We will be covering different topics of heat and mass transfer in future videos. So let's start today's part 1 of conduction. First topic is heat. We all know what heat is. Heat is amount of thermal energy which is transferred between two objects due to a temperature difference. So suppose we have ice which is at 0 degree centigrade, we all know that. Now it is in a surrounding having temperature 25 degree centigrade. Now what will happen? Ice will melt. Why? Because it is gaining some heat. So this is what heat means. Heat is energy which is transferred from surrounding to ice. Now it can take place in three modes. First mode is conduction. Second mode is convection. And third mode is radiation. When we talk about conduction, then we say that when heat transfer takes place, it takes place due to vibration of molecules. Suppose I am heating this rod in this fire. Now I am heating this rod. Now molecules at this end will vibrate and it will transfer energy from this part to other part because there are many molecules inside this rod. So this is how conduction works. When we talk about convection, then it occurs due to bulk motion of molecules. For example, I am heating this chamber of water or chamber of gas. Now due to motion of these particles, convection occurs. Now convection can occur in liquids and gases. It does not occur in solids because solid cannot diffuse into each other. When we talk about conduction, then it can take place in solid, liquid and gas. Radiation. Now thermal radiation can be defined as transfer of heat which does not require any medium. If you are sitting near this fire, then you will feel some heat even if you are sitting away from it because of radiation. So radiation can also be defined as transfer of heat due to electromagnetic waves, as you have seen in sun. We get sun's heat due to radiation. Now next topic is mechanism of heat transfer by conduction. Now there are two mechanisms of heat transfer by conduction. First mechanism is due to lattice vibration. Due to lattice vibrations, and second one is due to transport of free electrons. Now let's talk about due to lattice vibration. When I talk about due to lattice vibration, then molecules of substance, they continuously vibrate about their mean position. Suppose this is the molecule in this material. This is a bar. Now I'm heating this part by a flame. Now this molecule will vibrate at its mean position. Now these vibrations are known as lattice vibrations. Now we all know about kinetic energy of molecules. Now when solid vibrate in their lattice, the temperature of substance corresponds to its kinetic energy. For example, if they are vibrating, then their kinetic energy are increasing. If I will provide more heat, they will vibrate at more speed. So their kinetic energy will increase and their temperature will also increase. So the kinetic energy corresponds to their temperature. Now as the molecule starts vibrating, they collide with each other. Suppose there is another molecule here, here, here. So it will collide with each other and it will transfer its energy to this part. Similarly, all part will collide with each other and heat will transfer from one part to another part. So this is how lattice vibration works. Now when we talk about transport of free electrons, it is similar to conduction of electricity. Suppose this is the metal rod made up of iron. So mechanism of heat conduction and mechanism of transport of current, they both depend upon flow of free electrons. We all know about valence cells. Suppose this is an atom and it has one electron in its valence cell. Now what will happen if I will provide heat to this electron? I'm talking about this molecule, this atom here. So if I will provide heat to this valence electron, then it will go to higher state when it gains energy. Now they overcome the binding force to become free and move within the boundaries of solid. So these electrons are called free electrons. So these electrons impart their energy by moving from higher to lower level. As they come from higher to lower level, they will impart energy. So good electric conductors are generally good heat conductors like silver, copper, aluminium. Now this is the image of conduction. You can see, suppose we are heating a pan on a stove. So heat transfers to the pan by conduction. Next topic is Fourier's law of heat conduction. You have seen this expression. Now it states that rate of heat flow through a homogeneous solid is directly proportional to area, which is normal to direction of heat flow, and the temperature gradient, which is in direction of heat flow. So what does it mean? It says that suppose I am heating an object, any object, rod or a wall. Now here the rate of heat flow will be depending more on area. Means more area, more heat flow, more temperature gradient, more will be the heat flow. So this is what Fourier's law denotes. It can be written as Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx. Now here Q is heat transfer rate in given direction, A is area of heat flow which is normal to heat flow, dT is temperature difference between two ends, and dx is thickness of solid body. Suppose this is the wall and here temperature is T1 and here temperature is T2. So dT is this temperature difference and dx is thickness of solid body. So this is what Fourier's law denotes, and dT by dx whole is called temperature gradient in the direction of heat flow. Now we should know about assumptions in Fourier's law of heat conduction. When we talk about assumptions, then we have different assumptions. First assumption is heat flow is unidirectional under steady state condition. So what is steady state? When we talk about steady state condition, we say temperature of body does not vary with time. Del T is equal to zero. This is temperature, this is time. So first assumption is heat flow is unidirectional. Heat should be in unique direction, single direction, under steady state condition, means it does not vary with time. Second assumption is temperature gradient is linear and constant. Suppose this is a wall which I am heating. Now temperature gradient should be linear like this. It should not first increase and then it should not decrease like this. It should be linear. If it will be like this, then it is not applicable. It will only be applicable when temperature gradient is linear and it is constant. Constantly it is decreasing. This is second assumption. Third assumption is there is no internal heat generation within the body. Suppose this is the wall, and there should not be any source of heat. There should not be internal heat generation. Fourth is material is homogeneous and isotropic. It means thermal conductivity is same throughout the body in all direction. So Four assumptions are: first is heat flow is unidirectional under steady state condition. Second is temperature gradient is linear and constant. Third is there is no internal heat generation within the body. Fourth is the material is homogeneous and isotropic. Next topic is thermal conductivity. So thermal conductivity is the ability of material to conduct heat. Suppose we have material 1, material 2. So these are two different metals and I'm heating both these objects. Now what happens? This material take 10 minutes to reach to a temperature of 70 degrees centigrade and this material takes 50 minutes to reach to temperature 70 degrees centigrade. Then I say thermal conductivity of this material is more. It means the material is heating fast. It means it has more ability to conduct heat. So this is what thermal conductivity means. It means ability of a material to conduct heat. So different materials have different properties. As we know that metals conduct more heat than non-metals. So metals generally have higher thermal conductivity. Now we will talk about effect of temperature on thermal conductivity. First of all, we will talk about solids. What happens when we increase the temperature of solids? Now when we talk about solids, then we have two types of solids: metals and non-metals, metals or insulators, anything, metals and non-metals. Now we all know that heat conduction in solid is due to transport of free electrons and lattice vibration, as we have discussed before. Transport of free electrons and lattice vibration. Suppose this is a metal and I am heating it. Now when we heat a metal, then lattice vibration, they stop the motion of free electrons. It means the molecule will vibrate more. Due to their vibration, the motion is stopped. There is no motion, only they are vibrating more when I am increasing the temperature of this metal. Now due to this, thermal conductivity of pure metals decrease with increase in temperature. It means thermal conductivity of metals is inversely proportional to temperature. As I am increasing the temperature, the thermal conductivity is decreasing, because in metals heat is conducted due to free electrons, but when I am heating it, the lattice vibration are becoming dominant. They are dominant and they are stopping the motion of free electrons. That's why thermal conductivity is decreasing. Let's talk about non-metals. Now in non-metals, we know there are no free electrons to transport. That's why they are generally bad conductors of heat. So what happens here in non-metals, when we heat this part, so the molecule vibrates. Now here there is no motion, there is no electron motions. When I will not heat, then also there will be no electron motions. Means non-metals do not have any type of electron motions to conduct heat. So here what is happening here, only one factor dominates, that is lattice vibration. Here main factor to increase thermal conductivity is motion of free electrons, which is being stopped by lattice vibrations. Now here there is no free electrons to move, so what happens, it is only vibrating. Now due to vibration, their temperature is increasing. So that's why thermal conductivity of non-metals is directly proportional to temperature. So if I talk about metals and non-metals, I say when I heat the metal, thermal conductivity decreases. When I heat the non-metals, their thermal conductivity increases. Next, we will talk about gases. Now we know transport of heat energy by conduction in liquid and gases is due to random motion of molecules, which impart energy and momentum. So we also know that kinetic energy is function of temperature. So when the molecules of higher temperature, they collide with molecule at lower temperature, then they lose their kinetic energy by collision. Therefore, what happens in gases? So this is gases. Now they are different types of molecules. So when we heat the gas, these molecules will come close and they will start colliding with each other. Now due to collision, they will release more heat and they will conduct more. So when I heat the gases, their thermal conductivity increases. So thermal conductivity of gas increases with temperature. So K of gas is directly proportional to temperature. Now we will discuss effect of temperature on thermal conductivity in case of liquids. Now we have seen when we heat gas, they come closer. But what happens in liquid? When we heat liquid, they move far. The molecule separates. Due to this separation, their thermal conductivity decreases. So we can say that thermal conductivity of liquid is inversely proportional to temperature. So when temperature is increasing, it will decrease. Thermal conductivity will decrease. Now water is an exception. When I talk about water, then thermal conductivity of water is directly proportional to temperature. Next topic is thermal resistance. Let's compare it with electrical resistance. We have two resistance, one is rated 2 ohms and another one is rated 2 ohms. More current can pass through this, less current can pass through this, because we know if there is more resistance, current will be less. Less resistance, current will be more. So similarly is thermal resistance. Suppose this is the material and it has some temperature difference T1 and T2. I am supplying heat, suppose heat of 1000 degrees centigrade, but only 800 degrees Celsius is reaching in this rod. So it means it is resisting some heat. So this is known as thermal resistance. Now let's see the expression. We write Q, that is heat flow rate, is equal to temperature difference, which is dT upon dx by kA. So this is thermal resistance. There is another term which is known as thermal diffusivity. So thermal diffusivity is denoted by alpha. It is heat ratio of heat conducted to heat capacity. That is K upon rho into Cp, meter square per second. So the larger thermal diffusivity, the faster the propagation of heat into the medium, as it is directly proportional to thermal conductivity. So K represent how well a material conducts heat, and heat capacity, this represent how much energy a material stores per unit volume. Next topic is general heat conduction equation for constant thermal conductivity. So let's see what is the general heat conduction equation. So it is del 2T by del x square plus del 2T by del y square plus del 2T by del z square plus Qg by K is equal to rho C by K is equal to rho C by K into del T over del tau 1 upon alpha del T over del tau. Now here you can see this is the general heat conduction equation for thermal constant thermal conductivity. It is also known as Fourier Biot equation. It can be used to derive heat conduction equation in plane wall and spherical coordinates, etc. So let's see special cases of this. Now we are talking about special cases. First case can be when there is no internal source of heat generation. When there is no internal source of heat generation, then it can be written as del 2T by del x square plus del 2T by del y square plus del 2T by del z square is equal to 1. Now here internal heat generation is missing, because we are checking the case when there is no internal source of heat generation. So this is known as diffusion equation. It can be written as del square T del T over del tau. So this is known as diffusion equation. Now second case is steady state condition. Now in steady state condition, del T over del tau will be 0, so equation will become del square T upon del x square plus del 2T by del y square plus del 2T by del z square plus qg by k is equal to 0. So it can be written as del square T plus qg by k is equal to 0. So this is known as Poisson's equation. Now another case is third. Here what happens, here there is no internal heat generation. In absence of internal heat generation, now Poisson's equation will reduce to Laplace equation. Now second case which we talked about, Poisson's equation, in absence of internal heat generation, it will reduce to Laplace equation. So what is Laplace equation? Del 2T by del x square plus del 2T by del y square plus del 2T by del z square is equal to 0. So we write it as, so this is known as Laplace equation. So these are the cases. Thank you all of you for watching this video. I will be uploading more videos in future. I am separating two types of videos. I am making one video which is based on theory and another video which is based on numerical. So I will be uploading daily different videos on mechanical engineering. So thank you again. If you like it, then give a thumbs up. And if you want more videos, then you can subscribe my channel.